Penguin Random House Audio presents The Family Game, written and read by Catherine Steadman.
Prologue, 25th of December. I come to on the parquet floor of the entrance hall, my face pressed hard against its antique wood, with the clear knowledge that this is not how Christmases should go. Around me, the gothic grandeur of the hides slides back into focus. The Holbecks family seat. Everything multiple generations of wealth and power can buy you. This imposing Hungarian castle, ripped brick by brick from the Mecek Mountains, packed, shipped, and grafted into upstate New York soil. Their ancestral home, a literal castle in the sky, dragged to ground and anchored into the American landscape and its psyche. A testament to sheer bloody-mindedness and cold, hard cash. In the 1800s, a Holbeck bride wanted her beau to lasso the moon, and here's the solid proof he did. He made a dream real. Some might say more money than sense, maybe. But from down here, bleeding on their floor, even I have to admit this place is beautiful. And who in love doesn't hope for a lassoed moon? After all, that's what love is, isn't it? Across from me, the front door stands ajar, so close and yet so, so far. A crisp winter breeze tickling my face as I watch snowflakes float peaceably through the air outside, freedom just beyond my reach. Past that doorway, the grounds roll out in all their splendor. Snow-blanketed ornamental gardens, an ice-crusted boating lake, crystalline lawns that finally give way to miles of thickly packed Holbeck woodland. And at the limits of that moonlit forest, a 15-foot-high perimeter wall encircling us, separating the Holbeck family from the rest of the world. A sovereign state, an enclave, a compound with its own rules and self-regulating systems. I have been found lacking by one or all, and steps are in motion. I might not survive the night. If I could stand right now, if I could run and scale the perimeter wall, the nearest town would still be over an hour on foot. If I had my phone, I could call the police. But given who I am, who they are, I can't be sure the way things would go when they got here. There is a way to read any story, and I might have found myself with a slight credibility problem. A girl with a past tries to marry into money and all hell breaks loose. We all know how that story ends. It's funny, in-laws are supposed to be problematic, aren't they? That old cultural stereotype. I guess it's funny because it's often true. In-laws can be difficult. Families can be difficult. And I can't argue with the facts. Here, bleeding on their floor. I carefully ease up onto my forearms, the dark stone of my engagement ring shifting moodily in the light. A sleeping creature woken. If I could go back now, to the day he proposed, would I do things differently? That is the billion-dollar question. My temple throbs as I carefully wipe blood from my eyelashes. They say head wounds seem more serious than they are because they bleed so much. They say the human body can do incredible things in a crisis. People walked for miles to hospitals on broken legs after 9/11. Women give birth in war zones. New mothers lift cars to save their children. I hope that's true. 20 years ago, I almost died. I hung in silence, death all around me. But somehow, I survived. And if I could survive that, I can survive this. Because since you showed up, I have so much more to lose and so, so much more to gain. We're going to survive this, you and I. They say you can't choose your family, but they're wrong. You can. It just takes way more effort than most people are willing to put in. And with that thought in mind, I slowly push up and stumble to my feet. Chapter 1. Fairy Tale of New York. Monday, the 21st of November. Christmas lights twinkle in the rain as I duck down Fifth Avenue, red, greens and golds glimmering in reflection on puddles and glass as I dodge along the busy sidewalk, my phone pressed tight to my ear.
And the good news is, it's looking like we're going to hit the million copy selling mark by the end of this week. We did it, Harry.
My literary agent Louisa cheers on the phone. Her voice is warm and close, as if she were bundled up against the cold beside me in the sharp New York City chill. I try not to think of the 3,500 miles of distance between New York and London, between me and my old home and its soft, damp greyness. But every now and then, the pangs of homesickness awaken and stretch just beneath the surface of my new life. It's been 4 months since I left England, and the pull of home is somehow stronger now that the winter is setting in. New York can be cold in so many ways.
To all intents and purposes,
she continues with glee,
here's me saying you are now officially a million copy best-selling author.
I can't help but yelp with joy, a surreptitious half-skip in the street. The news is incredible. My first novel, a runaway bestseller, in the charts since publication. But this new milestone isn't something I could have ever dreamed of until now. New York swallows my ebullient energy greedily. I could probably lie down on the sidewalk and start screaming, and the festive shoppers would probably just weave around me unfazed. It's an oddly terrifying and yet reassuring thought.
We'll be getting another royalty payout from the publisher at the end of the quarter,
Louisa continues.
So, Merry Christmas, everyone.
It's funny, it's only November, and yet it does feel like Christmas here already. I look up to the halos of light hanging above me, holiday decorations sparkling from shop windows, strung in great swathes high over the main drag of Fifth. Everything seems to be moving so fast this year. A whirlwind, a whirlpool.
How's it going over there?
Louisa asks, snapping me back to reality.
Settled? Happy? Are you living love's young dream?
I let out a laugh of surprise because, yes, as smug and as self-satisfied as it may sound, I really am. After so many years alone, after pushing relationships away, perhaps I've paid in full for my mistakes and I can put them to bed. Maybe I'm finally allowed a little happiness. I shake off the dark thought and grasp back onto my new life with both hands. Well, we've got furniture now, at least. I'm not sure I've quite worked out the subway yet, but I guess I'll get there in the end. Or I guess I won't, I add jokingly. The truth is, while I know I'm beginning to get a feeling for New York City, I realise I'm trying to settle into a city that does not settle itself. The crowds, noises, faces, people, that frenetic fight-or-flight energy. I suppose it's only been 4 months. I know it can take a lifetime to become part of a city, to find your place. And the world I've landed into here with Edward, the new circles I find myself moving in, his rarefied life, that is something else again.
And how is your dreamboat? How's Ed?
She asks, as if reading my thoughts. I slip past a gaggle of tourists in front of St. Patrick's Cathedral, its bells tolling anachronistically, alongside towering glass and steel. Louisa was with me the night I met Edward. I shiver at the memory of the look she gave me when I first brought him over to meet her, that silent swell of pride I felt to have my arm hooked through his. The pride anglers must feel cradling their outsized, shimmering catches, though I can only credit chance and timing with my iridescent prize. In fact, it would probably be more accurate to say Edward plucked me from the stream than the other way around. I would be lying if I said Edward's background, his habits, his rituals, so alien to me, hadn't lent him a strange additional attraction. His world is different to mine. Everything he does invested with the subtle shimmer of something gilded. Not that I knew who he was when he first spoke to me. We met at my publisher's annual summer gala in London, a lavish star-studded party packed with best-selling authors, high-flying editors and super agents. That year, it was being held at the Natural History Museum, the vaulting Victorian architect.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.